Thank you, Tom. High energy as always. Love it. I'm going to take just a, we're a little bit ahead, and we have the evaluation forms that you can see Dave here parading around. We have folks in the back that can collect. So if you filled one out, again, that rapid feedback, we greatly appreciate it, and we'll pick them up while I'm talking here. So sort of behind the music here, I would like to recognize Dulce Barrios, who's standing here. So Dulce's been working the slides for us and being our troubleshooter. If you haven't met Dulce, she's our new epidemiologist and evaluator at the Office of Tobacco here at the Department of Health. So not only do you need to be like, have these the great skills of evaluation and epidemiology and statistical analysis, but if you can run a slideshow, you really appreciate it. So thank you.
Thank you.
So, okay, I'm gonna move right into, excuse me, next part of our presentations. And again, it's an honor. We have quite a stellar group of speakers today, as you can well imagine, and you've seen already. Dr. Steve Schroeder. So Dr. Schroeder, if I can call you Steve, is the Distinguished Professor of Health and Healthcare at the Division of General Internal Medicine at the Department of Medicine, UC San Francisco, where he also heads the Smoking Cessation Leadership Center. You can read your bio, his bio in your program, but I'm proud to say, honored to be a fellow board member along with Steve for the North American Quitline Consortium. He recently came on the board, and so we're enjoying a time there working with Linda Bailey, who you met earlier, as well as his stellar work in really looking at tobacco and people with mental illness. As we know, here in Arizona, right now we have about, in round numbers, about 700,000 Arizonans who still say they use tobacco at least occasionally, ranging from the maybe the cigar once a month on the golf course to the three-pack-a-day smoker. We have about 700,000 Arizonans who use tobacco. Well over 150,000 of that group are in our mental health system in Arizona. So from a population health perspective, when you can get your hands around a sizable population, you can make a huge impact in public health, not to mention adding years of life to people who otherwise are living anywhere from 10 to 30 years less than the average lifespan who are mentally ill. But when you look at the causes of death, they tend to mirror the causes of the general population. So high tobacco use, a very at-risk population, and a lot of health justice and social justice issues involved with that, I would probably suggest. Dr. Schroeder, earlier in his career from 1990 to 2002, was president and CEO of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Formidable job, and we're honored to have Steve with us. So Steve, without further ado, let's hear it for Steve Schroeder.
Thanks very much, Wayne. And hats off to Arizona for, as we heard today from both Matt and Charlene, for driving your smoking prevalence down to 14%. That's amazing. I think the central key take-home message from what I'm going to tell you today is you won't get it down much further unless you address the issue of people who smoke and have a behavioral health condition, either chronic mental illness or substance use disorders, or as often happens, both. This is my conflict of interest slide. There I am with Joe Camel. Anybody know where this is? Petra, Jordan. Yeah, it's an amazing place. And my conflict is not a financial one, but we have worked with Pfizer to distribute smoking cessation grants, but our center hasn't taken any money for that. So, I'm going to talk a little bit about the Smoking Cessation Leadership Center because I think our, just as you heard earlier today from other histories, our history illustrates some of the issues. So I began this center at UCSF when I left Robert Wood Johnson, and we were given a $10 million grant, which was supposed to last for 5 years, but we stretched it out to 13 for a variety of reasons. And our goal is very similar to the one that Linda told you about. It was to drive down smoking prevalence by lowering the numbers of smokers, by increasing quit attempts, and increasing the chance that those quit attempts would succeed. And I kind of naively thought I would just go, myself and my staff, to leaders of health professional organizations, tell them about the 5 A's, and they would say, oh, Steve, that's a great idea. How can we help? And it turns out that was not a very good strategy for two reasons. One is most of them have never heard of the 5 A's. And when I explained it to them, they said, give me a break. We're hamsters on a wheel. We don't have the 15 or 20 minutes it's going to take to do that. So we quickly went to a plan B, which is to at least acknowledge that you've got smokers, to advise them to quit, and then send them to the quit line to do the other 3 A's. And so that became one of our major strategies. And the first group that did that were the dental hygienists, and they branded this Ask, Advise, Refer. The other thing we did is we knew at the beginning that smoking was really concentrated in the behavioral health group of people. But we were told by the experts, don't go there. The culture is toxic. People don't want to quit. The substance abuse counselors are themselves former smokers. The psychiatrists go out and smoke with their patients. Don't go there. So for our first 3 years, we didn't go there, but then we had to go there. And so we followed the epidemiology. And I think the social justice issue that Wayne mentioned is, as opposed to my parents' generation, where smoking was pretty much distributed across the whole population. My parents were well-educated. Both of them smoked. Smoking today is really marginalized to some extent. The people who smoke are people with mental illness or substance use disorders, the homeless, people in prison, LGBT population. It's a different group. And the old paradigm probably isn't as applicable. So we wound up working with some partners that when I started, I didn't think we were going to work with. So just some of the data, I think some of this has come up previously, but of the now over 500,000 annual deaths from smoking, probably 240,000 of those are due to people with a behavioral health condition. And my guess is the proportion is similar here. This population consumes 40% of all the cigarettes sold in the United States. Don't think the tobacco industry doesn't know that. And why do they consume so many? A, they're more likely to smoke. B, when they smoke more cigarettes. And apparently if you go outside in an AA shelter, you'll just see the butts. So they not only smoke more cigarettes, they smoke them down way to the bottom. They die, as Wayne mentioned, earlier than others, and smoking is a major part of that. They're at greater risk for withdrawal from the nicotine when they stop, which means that we have to probably take greater care in sustaining treatments longer than the 8 to 12 weeks. I think Linda made that point. And many of people who work in a behavioral health condition say our goal is to create wellness, to restore these patients into the wellness community. If you're still smoking, even though you're sober and your medications have stabilized your chronic mental health condition, and you come in for a job interview, and you've got yellow teeth and yellow fingers and your clothes smell like cigarette, you're stigmatized. And so it's impossible really to get to the wellness if they keep smoking. So these are some of our health partnerships in the behavioral health sphere. And they haven't come easy, and each one has required a different courtship. But you can see it's a pretty large group now. And they're all coming around. And there are two major ways that we persuaded the leadership of these groups to work with us. One is just the data on the terrible toll that smoking exerts in this population. And second is the data on exposure to secondhand smoke. So the theory used to be, poor old Uncle Jeff, smoking's his only pleasure. Why should we deprive him of that? And then you say, well, little Timmy's coming in to visit Uncle Jeff. It's going to make his hearing worse. It's going to make his asthma worse. It's going to make his mom sicker. and so that often carries the day. One of the groups we worked with was SAMHSA, Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, and SAMHSA is about a $3.6 billion enterprise that essentially runs all of the public substance abuse treatment clinics and chronic mental illness clinics. And believe it or not, they had not seen smoking as part of their ambit. They just, because, you know, Congress funded us to do mental illness and substance abuse. And yet when Terry Klein, now of Oklahoma, was the director of SAMHSA under George W. Bush, and we made the pitch, he said, "You're absolutely right." And SAMHSA changed its priorities. So we had a summit at Lansdowne, which is outside of Dulles Airport, where we brought together a lot of leaders in the field and basically created a movement that this would be a legitimate public health and clinical enterprise. The first thing we did at SAMHSA was Terry and I and a couple other people actually did an in-service to their staff because tobacco was a foreign concept at SAMHSA. And then they said, "We'd like the Smoking Cessation Leadership Center, our center, to help us give out grants." So we gave very small grants, $2,000, to various clinics to help them to establish smoking cessation programs. We wound up with 100 clinics scattered all throughout the country. And then they asked us to work with states. So in both these instances, we became their arm and gave out SAMHSA money. And Arizona was the second SAMHSA state. I'm going to come back to that. And then there have been other versions of that, which are called an academy. So here's about you. In January 2011, you became the second state to hold the Leadership Academy for Wellness and Smoking Cessation. And this was at this point led by your Ashline. So there were some challenges, a lot of turnover in leadership, a lot of political issues, but the strong partnerships were sustained, and there were pilots to demonstrate the benefits of using the quit line to help employees quit. You provided evidence-based services to Arizonans, plus training and TA to partners in healthcare and other groups, and you've kept your eye on the prize, and I think that's probably one of the reasons that you were able to drive it down to 14, so thank you. Two of you for giving that message, and let's hope it can be kind of sustained. These are the states where we've worked, and you can see it wasn't easy pickings. Is the middle one the laser? No, okay. I don't want to turn it off. So you can just see that we didn't cherry pick. We didn't go to California. We didn't go to states with low prevalence. We went down, and we found, and one of the interesting things, we found amazing people in states like North Carolina and Kentucky and Mississippi. Out in California, we're a little biased. We live in our own blue bubble. And I think we were kind of surprised to find the amazing public health advocates in those states who really are fighting uphill and just doing a magnificent job. Thank you. And this is the area, by the way, where smoking rates are high, where obesity rates are high, where diabetes rates are high, and if we were to have a national health strategy, we ought to make it a regional strategy to really try to catch up to some of our European counterparts. So when we had these summits, we do a lot of pre-work and get people to say, who are the agencies that ought to be there to come up with a plan to drive smoking prevalence down in the behavioral health population? And there was a lot of back and forth, and then there was constructed an invitation list. And these are the state departments, mainly state departments, but some consumer organizations, some health providers, some advocacy groups like NAMI. What we often found is they hadn't met each other. They're working in their own, the alcohol people working in their silos, the tobacco people working in their silos, the mental health people, the substance use people. And we got together and we concocted common strategies to try to highlight smoking cessation. And it was very gratifying, and people heard about it, and they asked how we could do it. So this is an article that we published on this process in the American Journal of Public Health. It described the process and the interventions. We don't yet know fully how well they worked, Although I know that in Oklahoma, for example, they went from 49th in the nation to 38th in smoking prevalence in about 5 years. Now, 38 may not be bragging rights for states like Arizona and California, but they were really proud of that because that represented a lot of lives saved. The National Behavioral Health Network, where the National Council was able to get CDC grants from OSH to help states and other folks do a better job in the behavioral health field. And we've been essentially partnering with them and done some other summits because SAMHSA decided, although they liked the idea, their budget was so constrained, they couldn't fund it further. We've also worked with Pfizer. There's something called a speaker circuit. And if you have some prominence in the field, maybe not advocate of the year, but sort of less prominence than that, and publish, Pfizer or Glaxo or wherever will come to you and say, will you join our speaker circuit? We'll provide slides for you and we'll pay you. And I didn't want to do that because I thought that would put us at a conflict of interest. Finally, they said, would you work with us to give out smoking cessation grants? We said, yes, we'll do that if you let us do it free. They said, it's a deal. No one else had ever done that before. And so we gave out grants. We gave out about $6.5 million of grants to 55 organizations, and a large proportion of those were on smoking cessation and mental illness or substance use disorders or both. You got one here in Arizona. So the University of Arizona got a grant from Pfizer that we designed the RFP, we rated letters of intent. I think Linda Knack got one also. This one in Arizona was to improve cessation rates and reduce adverse medication interactions among tobacco users with mental health conditions. So this was an educational activity with video clips. It went all around the state, and I hope it reached some of you. This is just a little deeper look at smoking prevalence in the U.S. today. It's amazing the progress we've made. It is probably the most important public health breakthrough in the last 50 years, and yet we got a lot more to do, and people think it's yesterday's news. So that's a real problem. So what do we have? We have adult smoking at 15%, not much of a gender difference, not too much of an age difference except here. And the issue is here, they either quit or die. Poverty level, a huge issue. Education, graduate degree. Percentage of physicians who smoke today is at 1%, probably the lowest in the world. And then race, it's interesting. We have in the past tended to look at this as a racial issue, and with the important exception of Native Americans who are higher, although your work is going to drive it down. Whites and blacks essentially have the same rate. Hispanics and Asian Americans have lower rates. So this is not sort of the prototypical racial profile that you think of. And it used to be thought that as we succeed in smoking cessation, we'll get the low-lying fruit, and the smokers who persist will be those who are really hardcore. It's going to be really tough to crack that nut. Well, turns out that's not true. This is what's happened. Linda showed a version of this. This is smoking prevalence. This is till 2010, but it's continued to go down to 15%. And these are the number of cigarettes per day smoked by those who kept smoking. And it stayed at about a pack a day, and now it's down to about 14 cigarettes. So even those who keep smoking are smoking less. So it's theoretically not as hard to get them to quit as we might have feared. So you may have noticed an apparent paradox, that smoking rates are going down dramatically, and yet the number of people dying from smoking actually is climbed from 440,000 about 10 years ago to, according to one estimate from American Cancer Society, 540,000. Why did that happen? Well, there are really three reasons, and Linda just gave me a fourth today. As the prevalence declines, the toll increases. So why is that? we're better at figuring out how you die from smoking. And it turns out a lot of people who died of lung disease, the linkage in data sets weren't linked to their smoking. So an extra 60 to 70,000 people a year that they uncovered, people who are good at looking at these big data sets. And then the other that Linda mentioned is that the product is more lethal now. The other thing is with the new filters, people are inhaling more, so the cancers are showing up more on the periphery and probably don't show up clinically quite as early. My guess is we're going to plateau pretty soon, and the numbers of deaths are going to start going down. But whether it goes from 540 to 480 to 440, that's just a huge, huge toll. And yet, in public health, it's not nearly as visible as its numbers would merit. So we heard a lot today about public health actions to combat smoking, the federal excise tax, which President Obama raised to $1, ought to go up more, the Surgeon General's report, which was 53 years ago, the banning of TV ads, all the local and state smoke-free ordinances that we heard about, encroachments on giving cigarettes to the military and selling them to the VAs. General Pershing in World War I said, the key to our winning is send our boys two things, ammunition and cigarettes. And a lot of young men got hooked during World War I, during the Korean War, during the Vietnam War, during World War II, obviously. And now that's not done. And people have to be smoke-free during basic training, but then they're able to smoke afterwards. How many of you are old enough to remember smoking in the airplanes? It was miserable. First, you could smoke anywhere, and then they did something really smart. There's going to be a smoking section. So I'm here in the non-smoking section. The bathroom's there, and I start walking through. It was just terrible. And then finally, the smoking was banned. Hillary Clinton got her husband to ban smoking in all federal buildings, including the White House, in 1997. The Master's Settlement Agreement did a lot of things, including the creation of the Legacy Foundation, now known as Truth. Mayor Bloomberg wasn't the first mayor to ban smoking, but because the Big Apple is so prominent, I think it got the most notice. The National Quit Line, 2004, Secretary Thompson did the establishment of it and gave it a pretty memorable number, 100 quit now. The regulatory of the FDA has been more a potential weapon than a meaningful one now. We'll see what happens. All of these things, all these important policy actions were driven by the science about both first and secondhand smoking, evidence of the duplicity of the tobacco industry, and the progressive denormalization of smoking. And to illustrate that, California has a lot of Asian immigrants. You do too, I think. Many of these people come from countries where the prevalence of smoking among men is close to 50%. And yet, as you saw in the earlier slide, Asian Americans in this country have a very low smoking rate. It isn't that only the non-smokers come to the U.S., it's that they come to places like California and they realize it is no longer acceptable to smoke publicly. So the denormalization has been a critical component, and people in the room have made a contribution to that. So, a number of my public health friends, I think unwisely, create a tension. Either you do public health or you do cessation. Cessation's hopeless, not worth doing because most people can't quit. Well, it's not that simple. And these are some data. Linda gave you a version of these earlier. About 70% of people want to quit. About 55% tried. About 7.5% did. About 60% were advised by their clinician to quit, but only about a third got evidence-based treatment. And in terms of smoking cessation, even people with mental illness, it used to be thought that they didn't want to quit. They know, they're smart, they know what smoking does to you, they're just as interested. And by age, the younger smokers are more interested. Those with graduate degrees are more interested, those of them that smoke, and the folks in the Northeast. So to keep going, recent quit attempts, about 55%, highest in Asian Americans, lowest for low education. And the reason quit smoking, you can see those data. So I don't know whether we can, our center can take any credit for this. We got started in 2003, but didn't really fully ramp up about 2005. But Pfizer had a new drug come on the market. The Affordable Care Act did better coverage. But what's happened, these are still really low, but there's a tripling in the smoking cessation rates. And in public health terms, that's enormous. So we should keep focusing on that. Now, Pfizer makes a drug called varenicline, which is known in its trade name as Chantix. And it's a designer drug that specifically fixes on the nicotine receptors in the brain so that when you smoke, you don't get as much of a buzz and you don't get as much of the dopamine, which then when you smoke and you get dopamine, it goes to the frontal lobes and you go, oh, that's really great. You get the same kind of a buzz from sex, from cocaine, from alcohol, and in my case, from hearing Beethoven, but I'm sort of a strange dish there. There were some early reports of suicidal thoughts and actual suicide in people who use this, and rare, but very worrisome. And there were three possible reasons for it. One is that stopping smoking for some people can be really devastating. The other is people with mental illness and bipolar illness are more likely to smoke and are more likely to kill themselves anyhow. And the third is it could have been a rare occasion from the drug. So the FDA put a black box warning on varenicline, and its sales, which had been going up, because it's a pretty good drug, sort of plummeted. There recently was a study in The Lancet to show that it may not have been all that risky, and so the FDA is going to take the black box warning off. The other thing that varenicline may do is it may reduce craving for alcohol in problem drinkers, so it may be a twofer drug. For people in the mental health treatment community, smoking is tricky, because they come into the hospital, most psychiatric hospitals are now smoke-free, their medications get stabilized, the ingredients in smoke, not the nicotine, but all the other 7,000 stuff, work on liver enzymes that deconjugate a lot of medications. And these are some of the psychoactive medications. So what happens is you get your level all stabilized, you leave the hospital, you start smoking again, the liver breaks the medications down more, and suddenly you're undertreated. And so this is another very good reason for people not to keep smoking after they're in the treatment situation. So I'm going to show you a summary for the whole general population about the evidence as to what works. And I want to give you some caveats first. Smoking is a chronic condition, and so it may be a little simplistic to think you can treat it for only 12 weeks. We don't treat diabetes or hypertension for 12 weeks. Secondly, smokers really vary from the occasional smoker to the really heavily addicted smoker, and you need to tailorize your treatment. Third, volunteers for this study are likely to be more motivated to quit, and that's partly why the quit rates for quit lines are so high, is that you've got to be motivated to call the quit line in the first place. Fourth, the placebo arms and the drug arms tend to get really state-of-the-art counseling, probably better than you get in the real world. And finally, most drug trials exclude patients with chronic mental illness. The little bullet at the bottom is one of my colleagues at UCSF treated people for a long time and found that with people with chronic mental illness, they had a 50% prevalence of smoking cessation, which is amazing, a lot better than most people say. So here's the data. Both the yellow and the blue bars got state-of-the-art counseling. The yellow bars, in addition, got these drugs. And I would urge you to sort of think of two things. One is, probably the spontaneous quit rate is 4%. So just counseling by itself doubles it. If you add drugs, it's even higher. You can't necessarily compare each of these because the circumstances are different, but probably varenicline may be the best drug. but not by a large amount. And so you need to engage patients, explain the possibilities, and get them to pick the one that fits them best. And if that doesn't work, go back and try something else. So we encountered a lot of myths on smoking and chronic mental illness and other things. And Jody Prochaska, who was at UCSF and is now at Stanford, wrote a nice little summary in the New England Journal about these myths. One is tobacco is self-treatment. So people don't always have to smoke to treat their symptoms. It turns out that there was a confusion in that when you stop smoking, you get anxious because you're getting withdrawal from the nicotine. And they were conflating nicotine withdrawal with the underlying illness. And interesting, a lot of the studies that said don't stop smoking were sponsored by guess who? Philip Morris. The second myth was they don't want to quit. Essentially, they want to quit at about the same 70% rate as the general population. The third is they can't quit. And what Jody and others and Sharon Hall have shown is that, yeah, they can quit. Maybe slightly less rates in the general population, but they can certainly quit. A guy named Glassman in the 90s published a lot of articles saying people with mental illness, especially chronic depression, who quit smoking exacerbate their underlying illness. Turns out that's not true. Nobody's been able to verify that. But that became part of the psychiatric training. And so people said, oh no, we can't stop smoking. And then it's a low priority problem. And I can understand in the face of a schizophrenic break or a suicide attempt, smoking seems pretty derivative and not all that critical. But in fact, it's what kills the patients much more than their underlying chronic mental illness. So I'm grateful to Jody for having published that. So why help mental health consumers quit? Better quality of life, live longer, the medication issue I told you, the social isolation I told you about, money. Huge amount, a study from Jersey showed that for people getting chronic SSI, social payments for people who are disabled, a third of that money was used to buy cigarettes. So think of all the good things that could be done if it weren't spent on smoking. I've always been wondering how many of the panhandlers that you see are looking not for food, not for housing, not for alcohol, not for drugs, but for cigarettes. But nobody studied that yet. And quitting smoking helps you to get better. So this was Jenna Taylor in the British Medical Journal 2.5 years ago, did a review of 26 papers. Really important study. This is maybe the most important study to take home with you. They found that smoking cessation lowered depression levels, lowered anxiety, lowered stress, and improved mood and quality of life. And the effect sizes, that is the magnitude of the change of smoking cessation, was equal to or greater than antidepressive drugs for mood or anxiety disorders. So just getting people to stop smoking is a treatment in this population, not a deterrent. This is the financial impact. You can see, and obviously the dollars per day, if your pack a day depends on what state you're living in. I think Missouri still has the lowest state taxes. I think Rhode Island has the highest. Although there's some cities that add on to that. But this is a lot of money, particularly if you're an impoverished person. And Chad Morris found that on a population level survey, those with a mental health diagnosis tried to quit more often, used nicotine replacement therapy more often, were more optimistic about quitting, and had more provider advice to quit. It makes sense when you think of that a psychiatrist or a psychologist spends a lot more time with a person with mental illness than a primary care physician does. That usually they're given 40 to 45 minutes, primary care physician maybe 10 or 15 minutes. So Linda was talking about what drives people to the quit line, and when things got tough in state governments, paid media advertising, which is, you know, what the quit line does is says, how did you happen to call us? And you saw what happened with the TIPS campaign, that the numbers went up. Over time in California, as the state budgets got cut from 2004 to 2010, the numbers of calls generated by that went down. But the number of calls by clinicians, stimulated by clinicians, actually went up. So even if your clinicians don't themselves become smoking cessation experts, they can do a great job at steering people to the quit line. And if they call the quit line, not enough of them do, but if they call the quit line, they've got almost a 30% chance, or a 1/3 chance of quitting. Now, when we were starting to do this, quit lines are an interesting phenomenon. They want to be of service, but they don't want to be overwhelmed because they're afraid that people are going to go to the state and say, you're not giving us good care. And so we said, we like people with mental illness to call you more often. And our quit line in California said, oh my God, don't do that. It's going to clog up the quit line. These are people who are not articulate. They'll take a long time. They'll tie up our operators. And we said, how do you know they're not already calling? Turns out they were. They did a survey. And it turns out, that over 50% of them had one or more of these issues. So we've been working with Linda's group and Chad Morris and others to try to train quitline operators in various states to do a better job at intake. And I think that's actually been happening. And so we're really proud that despite the conventional wisdom that people with this condition can't quit, in fact, the rate of decline in this population is somewhat greater than the rate of decline in people without a behavioral health condition, starting from a much lower level, obviously. So it's not a lost cause, and it's a cause where you have the most to gain. So I would urge Arizona, and I know I'm meeting with some folks sort of tomorrow, but maybe to explore this further. What more can you do? You're probably doing lots now. Online smoking cessation is available for those who would rather do it on a computer as opposed to a telephone. So I'm coming down the home stretch here. What are the barriers to successful cessation? I'm going to read these out. A key one, and I'm afraid it's still there, or it's a little better, is that most clinicians either don't want to do it or are pessimistic or bummed out that it's not going to work out. Codependency and mental illness, we've touched on that an awful lot. No coverage for smoking cessation. Even though the ACA provides it, and ACA may not be with us for long, a lot of the state Medicaid programs didn't comply. So there was incomplete fulfillment of that promise. Improper use of the medications, the use of, for example, the gum, you don't chew it like a chiclet. You chew it very differently. And so often it requires pharmacists to help people. Far, as Linda pointed out, far, far underutilization of the quit lines. The major cuts to the budgets, even before the potential killing of the $1 billion prevention campaign fund, but the cuts to the budgets at the state level, and the fact that smokers don't have a lot of cachet at the state level. Even in one state, they tried to roll back the state tobacco taxes. So how can you increase quit rates? Well, reframe expectations of success. A lot of clinicians say, oh my God, if I do a really great job, only 20% of people are going to quit and 80% won't. But if you put that on a population basis, that's a huge yield if you go from 5% to 20%. Help businesses to help their workers quit. Third one we've talked a lot about, fourth one we've talked a lot about. Develop new drugs that would be helpful, and I'm hoping pharma is going to keep doing that. Better systems and more champions. So for those of you, how many of you work in a clinical setting? Okay, well, I won't spend a lot of time on this thing, but you might want to ask your colleagues to get a carbon monoxide breathalyzer because it gives the parts per million of CO, and that's much higher in smokers. And smokers can track that over time, and it only costs $500. You can use it for a very, very long time until it breaks. So we may be at a tobacco tipping point. So you're down low. National prevalence is almost as low. We worked with Northern California Kaiser, which serves millions of people, and helped them get their prevalence down to under 9%. Physician smoking prevalence, I told you, 1%. CVS Caremark stopped selling tobacco products. We've been working with Target and Safeway to activate their pharmacists. Cigarette butt pollution as a new thing. Takes a lot of time and effort and money to pick up the butts. San Francisco may impose a tax, a butt tax. higher insurance premiums for smokers are permitted under the ACA. We've heard about the campaigns. The final bullet there is, we don't know what's going to happen with President Trump. We know that his vice president has been pretty cozy with the people who make cigarettes, so I'm not optimistic about that, but we'll see. We have major knowledge gaps. The NIH doesn't sponsor smoking cessation trials. There is a new drug, cytisine, which is not new. It's been around from Poland. It's a natural extract. It acts somewhat like a varenicline does. It's really cheap, but because you can't get a patent on it, you can't get it here in the United States. So it would be really cheap as an over-the-counter. Menthol. Although African Americans smoke at about the same rate as whites, they die more often from lung cancer. And people think it's because the menthol fools you, and African Americans are much higher rate of using menthol, and they inhale deeper. So there's a lot still that we don't know. The e-cigarette is probably the most controversial one, and it's split the public health community, which has a history of being somewhat fractious anyhow. Is it safe? The British say that it's about 95% safer than a combustible cigarette. It's probably not totally safe. It's probably not as safe as this room air, but it's a lot safer than a Camel. Will it help people quit? Probably some. We don't know how many. Is it a gateway drug? Well, a huge number of kids are smoking, yet at the same time, youth smoking are vaping. But youth smoking of combustible cigarettes, as you've seen today, is at an all-time low. So it's probably not a gateway to combustible cigarettes. And I think we'll skip the rest. So where are we today? Well, I think what makes our job so difficult is most policymakers who control budget and make regulations and influence people live in a gated community. Sally and I were married 50 years ago this year. For our wedding gifts, we got some fancy ashtrays. We have not had a smoker in our house for probably 25 years. We don't know anyone who smokes. Our sons don't know anyone who smokes. We know some people who take a little dope now and then, not many. And we hear that they're vapors. But so people assume, because they don't know it, and journalists too, that journalists used to be high smokers, but they are now, that it's a done deal, that it's all taken care of. And I mentioned smoking is marginalized. So this is why, as Wayne said, it's become a social justice issue. And we're also having to pay attention to some of the new products and the newly opened up old products like marijuana. And meanwhile, the tobacco industry understands they're fighting a rearguard action, but they want to sustain their sales locally as much as possible and then expand overseas market. So again, many congratulations to you all. You've come a long way, but there's even more that you can do. So thank you.